At a time the 70s hit parade was choked by lively pop, a record of dead people speaking inspired a new faith.
The experimenter asked her how she felt in the beyond, and a voice answered in German, "Imagine, I am."
The belief in taping messages from the dead even won the backing of a pope, a fact that has stayed secret until now.
I speak to dead people, and not only I can hear them, you could hear them too.
People around the world believe that they can use ordinary cassette players to record messages they claim are the voices of the dead. The devotees of an acoustic anomaly called the electronic voice phenomena make tapes they say prove the afterlife exists. By simply recording in silent rooms, the faithful believe anyone can summon the dead to leave messages that can cure grief, restore faith, and even give a glimpse of heaven.
To help the air adapt itself to the strange rhythm, rapidity, and softness of the voice entity's speech, each utterance is repeated several times.
Those who hear the voices have had their lives changed forever. Engineer Alec McRae lives on the remote Isle of Skye off the west coast of Scotland.
Well, I'm going to a spot where I think I may be able to get archaic voices on the electronic voice apparatus, which I've got with me. And, well, it's an experiment. We'll see how it goes. It'll be interesting if it happens.
Alec is an international designer of voice communication systems. He developed speech enhancers for NASA's Space Shuttle astronauts and radio links for London's underground trains. It was 20 years ago that Alec read about the electronic voice phenomena known as EVP.
I sort of came across EVP by accident, and I rejected it totally, first of all, when I read a book about it. And it was something about tape recording the voices of people who had died. I knew that was nonsense, that couldn't be done, so I just slung it back on the shelf. A couple of weeks later, and I was really, you know, annoyed about it. I picked it up once again, you know, girl, as it were, and I found them there. There's some photographs of people who were prominent in the electronics industry, and they were looking into it. I thought, well, if it's good enough for them, I ought to take a look at it as well.
Alec decided to build his own machine to see if he too could hear the voices of the dead.
Basically, it is like a sort of radio transmitter which one controls by placing one's hands on those plates here. And this modifies the radio signal, which is picked up by the radio, and that is recorded on the tape recorder. And then when we listen back to that, we find that sometimes you will get a voice sound on there.
When Alec listened to his very first recording, he was convinced he could hear the voice of a dead man.
That was the first EVP voice that I ever recorded, and it really just sent cold shivers up and down my spine. It seemed to me to be saying, a very strange, sick kind of voice was Carl Johnson, Carl Dyer. It sort of tails off at the end, as though, you know, somebody really was on their last legs. So they are definitely speech forms and not static. But it had quite an impact, really. It was quite convincing.
Alec's professional interest in perfecting a machine to reach the dead turned personal when someone he loved died.
My father, he died on the 5th of January, 1982. And it spurred on my interest in EVP because, here was a person that I'd known that was gone. All that life was gone. It made one think, you know, what is it about? And we don't know. So EVP is a way of finding out a bit more.
But after 20 years of listening, Alec has heard nothing but the voices of strangers.
Where's your mama gone?
EVP found me. I didn't find it. To hear from Paul like that, 2 years after he'd died, it was just the most amazing and wonderful thing that had ever happened in my life. These are all his pictures. Oh, that's a great one, isn't it?
Judith Chisholm, a former journalist with the Sunday Times, runs a society promoting EVP from her London home.
Beautiful, isn't it?
Yeah.
In 1992, she was struck by the sudden death of her eldest son, Paul.
I went through periods of enormous depression and loss and grief and, you know, just anguish, really.
Judith could not accept Paul's death. In desperation, she and her other son, Vic, began attending seances to try to contact him. After recording a sitting, they heard an unexpected voice.
The woman's voice, which came onto the tape, it was just a very soft and very gentle voice, almost a whisper, and she just said, Judith. Just like that, Judith.
The electronic voice phenomena is real. It is absolutely real.
Judith.
The whisper convinced Vic and Judith they could use a tape player to record a message from Paul.
Vic and I were sitting together to try to record for EVP voices. So I'll play that now.
Ask to speak to Paul. I think he might be more likely to reply to you.
Hello, Paul. Are you there?
Paul Chisholm.
I felt you were here today when... And there was a knock in the kitchen, a loud knock.
No, but we stopped some pie for her and you dropped it, and that was what made the last time.
Yeah, very funny. Yeah, well, listen, can you not help us?
It's just incredible. I mean, Paul, in spirit, finished off the sentence, can you not laugh at us?
Help us.
It is him. It's his voice. It's his intonation. He spoke faster than Vic. And he had this little gap in his front teeth as well. And I can even hear that slight whistle behind his voice. And we were just completely overwhelmed to think that he was there listening and participating in what we were doing.
Until now, Alec McRae has worked on his voices alone. But his technical know-how has made him a celebrity. In July, he was invited to an EVP conference in Plainfield, Indiana, to talk to other people who capture the voices of the dead.
There are going to be a lot of very interesting speakers from different specialities, so I'm really looking forward to it. I'm quite excited about it, in fact.
The main speaker is the founder of America's EVP movement, Sarah Estep.
And this first one is Murder. And she is walking around in the basement of an old hotel, and somebody was murdered there probably 100 years or more ago. And as she's walking around, you hear this word, Murder!
Old and new followers of EVP have come together to try to reach the dead.
Okay, now those of you that have a tape recorder, just stand and we will assign people to you. Fine. Okay, you just take them off somewhere, wherever you want to go, and good luck to everyone. So try to come back to us within 20 minutes maximum.
Okay.
Alec joins Lisa Butler, the head of the American Association of the Electronic Voice Phenomena, to summon the voices.
I welcome those from the other side in and ask them if they have a message for us. Well, I hope you all were as excited about the conference as we were. It certainly got me jazzed up.
Yes.
After making a recording of silence, the tapes are played back to find out if any messages from the beyond have been left for them.
All right.
Right. Okay, then. Oh, I think so.
Okay, let's see.
I welcome those from the other side in and ask them if they have a message for us.
Sounds like
a knocking. That's just me not.
Or was that somebody in the room?
Who slices those?
That's a EVP voice.
It's a new.
I guess it was enough.
We've all had time now to go off and make our recordings in our groups. Do any of you think that you might have gotten a message while you were recording in your group, in your small group? Lisa, you and Alex think you may have.
Yes, we might have. There were very low voices, and there was noise around, so we want to carefully listen to them and make sure that they're not just voices from outside the room.
EVP had its origins outside America. In 1959, a Swedish filmmaker, Fredrik Jörgensen, was taping birdsong in a forest for a documentary about the slaughter of migratory songbirds. When he played back the tapes, among the birdsong he heard a voice he recognized as his dead mother. Jörgensen wrote a series of books about the messages from the dead, calling them the electronic voice phenomena.
The voice calls the experimenter's family name, Raudive.
But it was Costa Raudive, a disciple of Jörgensen, who spread the voices around the world. Raudive taped 70,000 messages in 6 different languages from silent rooms and radio static.
And now we hear in Latvian and German, Costa, tu tic na. Costa, you are so near.
In 1971, Costa Raudive released a 7-inch record to promote his book, Breakthrough. Raudive had labored to categorize every brief and seemingly bizarre message.
The voice says, Du hast kein Flüssigon.
He concluded not only that the voices respond to questions, but that proper interpretation of what they said could reveal what life was like beyond the grave.
The experimenter states, man cannot grasp the events after death with his intellect. A voice replies in German, he can.
The Raudavay messages became EVP's most influential testament. 25 years later, Raudavay's own voice reached from the grave to inspire American Dale Palmer. The Indiana Conference hears of the moment of his conversion.
When Dale and I first met, he asked if Constantine Raudavay was here. Within a few seconds, a clear, fast male voice responded with, "Yes, Raudavay is here."
Raudavay is here. When I heard that and recognized that that was an answer to my question, I was hooked.
The Indiana Conference is to hear about a new EVP breakthrough.
Dale Palmer was going to unveil a computer system which is going to enable people who can access the internet to perform EVP experiments on their own.
Dale Palmer is a former district attorney with a visionary plan, a website to provide proof of contact with the dead.
If anyone in the world can get on their computer and communicate with their dead grandfather, I don't like that word dead because there is no such thing. You cannot die. Jesus didn't die. And if Jesus didn't die, then I won't die and you won't die. Okay? So, if anyone in the world can speak to their loved ones in another dimension, think of the impact it will have on this culture.
The following section deals with examples of voices. The experimenter has evolved 6 different methods of recording. Microphone, radio frequency, diode, frequency transmitter, goniometer, and psychophone.
In 1971, an American millionaire and industrialist was inspired by Raudavay's voices.
I am a visionary. Here is my vision. I said, within 50 years, which is just an instant of time in the march of civilization, other inventors will have perfected the communication system. Then billions of people on the planet will each know that there is electronic proof that death is not the end of life. The dead are still very much alive.
George Meek set out to build a new machine that would not just play back short messages, but have live, two-way conversations with the dead. Meek believed he could end global conflict and prejudice by having the dead themselves tell world leaders that regardless of race and religion, all souls were joined in the afterlife.
After years of research and experimentation, an exciting breakthrough for metascience came with the development of Spiracom.
Spiracom converted radio frequencies into 13 buzzing tones designed to act as carrier signals for speech.
Was a tremendous advance on what everybody else had been doing. They were just picking up voices, you know, short statements, but here was this guy apparently communicating with the other side.
After 3 years of work, William O'Neill, an electronic technician and psychic, achieved his first actual voice exchange with a man who announced that he was Dr. George Mueller, who had died in 1967.
But this secret videotape of Bill O'Neill using the Spiracom was never made public.
2:15. I just forget what time it is. What's that, sir?
You know better than that. I'm not aware of the time.
The voice is sometimes friendly with O'Neill.
Is that not right, William?
Yes, that's right, Doctor. I'm sorry, sir. Please forgive me.
That's all right, William. That's all right.
All right, sir.
At other times, it's menacing.
Dr. Mueller? All right, sir.
William O'Neill had long conversations with Dr. Mueller, who had been on the other side for some time. And I was just so impressed. I had never heard such long conversations with it. Oh, that is just wonderful. George was very, very impressed. And then about a year or so later, he introduced the Spiracom system in Washington, D.C.
George Meek decided to reveal his vision at the epicenter of the world's media, the Press Club in Washington, D.C. Meek stepped into this lion's den, convinced the voice of his cranky ghost would ignite a spiritual revolution. When an American millionaire built a machine to talk to the dead, he wanted the world to hear about it. Far, far away. George Meek's Washington press conference was to be the high point for the followers of the electronic voice phenomena.
It is my pleasure to present to you George Meek.
We have chosen Easter week to make this announcement for reasons that will shortly become apparent. For many Christians, our findings may be one of the most significant items of news in 2,000 years. The findings I am announcing today are truly fantastic and far out. For the first time, we have electronic proof that the mind, memory banks, and personality survive death of the physical body.
Yes, sir.
We call our equipment Spiracom, short for Spirit Communication.
William O'Neill stayed silent as reporters heckled Meek about his conversation with a dead man.
Why should we accept what seems to be scientifically a miracle story?
The gentleman asked why we should expect any of you people to accept the cock and bull story. Frankly, we don't expect you to accept this story. All we are asking today, all we're attempting to do in this press conference, is to ask you to perform your function of reporting this information, reporting this news, to your readers, listeners, and viewers.
Meek's press conference made international headlines.
George took the Spiracom system and went to many, many countries around the world.
But feedback from Meek's global mission was not what he'd expected.
When people would hear these sample tapes, just like I had, they'd say, oh, that's the kind of results we want to have. And so they would buy the Spiracom manual, and it told how to build the system and so forth. And they would build it, and then they would sit at their tape recorder, and they would use the Spiracom system. No one in the world, no one had the results with Spiracom, as William O'Neill is given credit for having.
Yes, sir?
What's wrong?
Nothing's wrong, sir.
That can be very easily faked. There was a very old record, it's played in the 1940s for kids, and that called Sparky's Magic Piano, which was about a piano that could talk.
But you're talking!
I can talk.
And it just produced exactly the same kind of sounds.
Your time is up, I will no longer play for you.
Meek's triumph ended in shame when, like Sparky's Piano, his Spiracom refused to speak again.
Oh, boy. Dr. Mueller, are you there, sir? Oh, my God.
But Meek himself continued to protest that the Spiracom voice was genuine.
I am not about to perpetrate any hoax. Our findings will withstand the closest possible scrutiny by the scientific community.
Before he died, Meek explained why he had spent his life and fortune on a device to prove that all races and religions are united after death.
The result will be nothing less than an evolutionary leap for mankind. There will be no more war, murder, or suicide. That is the legacy I want to leave my children and grandchildren and yours.
I'm sorry, sir. Please forgive me.
That's all right, Reagan. That's all right.
Oh, boy.
And so that is the unfortunate history of Spiracom. Spiracom has been DEAD for probably 12, 15 years.
But the death of Spiracom was not the end. All around the world, people keep coming across the voices. The voices EVP believers now hail as the miracle of Dundee were first heard in this empty building. 3 years ago, cleaning lady Linda Williamson was working with a friend when she heard strange noises. She decided to record them.
That's when we got the voices on the tape, which was unbelievable when we first heard it. It was very frightening. We didn't know what was happening. We actually hear two women talking to each other, laughing. Were they referring to us? Were they seeing us? We never seen anything of them, you know.
Linda had never heard of anyone recording spirits' voices, but she became drawn into it because her father had recently died.
It was my friend that says, if you could get voices in a deceased person, why don't you try for your dad? And at first I wasn't too sure, but then I did try, and I was amazed the first time round I actually got my father's laugh. That was the first time I'd heard in relating to my dad, and then I got him 2 days later actually trying to speak. I speak to dead people, and not only I can hear them, you could hear them too. Well, they don't come in a big conversation.
Magdy.
They're just saying hello, it's Mary or it's George, whatever. They're just basically coming in and saying hello to the person.
Well, very soon after I bought this, I thought I'd do a little experiment. And it records for an hour, so... So what I did is I came up to bed one evening and I just simply switched it on and I put it here, just like that. And I got into bed and went to sleep quite quickly. And then the next day, when I played it back, it was absolutely full of talking from one end to the other. I mean, an hour of talking. And a lot of the voices were making reference to me, like, things like, she's lying in bed, get her out. And the whole thing was full from beginning to end of spirit voices. And it was incredible. Now, when they're speaking to me, this red light flickers. Well, I mean, it sounded like some vast place that they were in. All talking like mad to each other. The overall impression was just of thousands of people. Maybe I was connecting to the plane that we all go to when we die. It sounded like some huge hall where everyone was assembled. And maybe that's where people go until they're sorted out emotionally, if they've had any emotional problems, and maybe you have to work things out there in that kind of a place before you go to wherever you are allocated next. I mean, all I know is what I was able to record, which was just a mass of voices from nowhere, but in actual fact from what I believe was the spirit world.
Comforted by her own experience, Linda felt the voices could help others.
At one stage, our friend was quite distressed at the loss of her mother. So we invited her up and we put a recording on and we got a few things for her. And we felt that she got a lot from it and she felt a wee bit better. And I said to Irene, could we not help people with this instead of, just keeping it to ourselves? Why don't we do something with it, something positive? Since I've been doing this electronic voice phenomena, we put an advert in a newsagent's and then we started getting group sittings. What we're actually doing tonight is taking recordings and hopefully we'll be getting voices from deceased people that's going to come through tonight on a tape recorder. This process is called electronic voice phenomena, and it totally amazes me that we could put a recorder on and just talk amongst ourselves and play it back and discover that there's been voices added, and hopefully that you people here tonight is going to recognise if you're getting anything on the tape. Denise, who would you like to see if we could try and make contact with on the tape?
My dad, Henry.
Your dad's Henry.
My cousin, Billy.
My cousin, Billy. Helen.
My daughter, Fiona.
Fiona.
My dad, James. And my mum, Helen. Yeah.
Okay, well, we can only just ask. We can't demand anything. Going to take a recording. I was sitting here, just talking, basically. Now, I'm going to use a further tape here as proof that I'm not doing anything to the tapes. So, people, if you're willing to walk forward, I've got Denise here, and she's asking specially for Henry, Billy. Would anybody would like to walk forward, see something special for Denise?
Now, Billy's my cousin and he died in a tragic drowning accident when he was 8 years old. Basically, that's about 34 years ago. I'm hoping to hear from my dad, Henry. I've always grieved for my dad. We've always been quite a close family and like to hear something positive for my mum's sake. My mum misses him terribly.
Right, people, I'm asking for Helen, who's asking especially for Fiona, her daughter, and her mother and father, James and Helen.
Fiona, she was 6 years old. She died of meningitis. She came home from school and said, Mummy, got a sore tummy. That was on the Tuesday, and by a week into Wednesday, we had lost her. It just, the whole bottom fell out my world. When Fiona died, it was just devastating. I just wanted to see if Fiona could come through in any way to me. She was there. Could she show that she was there? That was all, you know. I've never forgotten her voice. Never forgotten her voice.
Are there anybody else that's not written down in the list would like to walk forward and say who they are and who it's aimed for tonight? So people just need to wait for you to take your time to walk in. I wouldn't like to call this a modern day seance. I don't like the word seance. I always pray about it, I mean, behind the scenes. So we'll just let the tape run and let my people come in. And I'm asking if you would walk forward and make the contact with your family.
Say, might be. Say, might be. Won't be go.
I was in a bit of turmoil because of what my faith was telling me was wrong. It says in the Bible not to raise up spirits and things like that. I remember being down on my hands and knees for 3 days praying to my crisis, personal belief between me and my Creator. And I was asking if this was nothing to do with him, that he was the strongest one out of the two years to deal with us and to take this from me. And I totally put my trust in Christ and asked him to deal with us.
Linda's turmoil arose from the 2,000-year-old testaments of Deuteronomy and Leviticus that ban seances and prohibit communication with the dead. Under these stern edicts, could Linda, Alec, and all those who record the voices be guilty of sorcery and the sin of conjuring spirits? The Vatican has never made any public pronouncement about the electronic voice phenomena. But this priest knows the secret of the Pope and the ghost voices. Inside a Belgian monastery, a priest lies dead. A guest at the funeral is one of Europe's foremost theologians. He is also keeper of a deep secret. 50 years ago, the Pope believed he heard the voice of a dead man.
My name is François Brun, and I am a Catholic priest in the Catholic Church, and studied in the Institut Catholique in Paris, in the Biblical Institute in Rome, and I was professor for theology or Holy Scripture in France.
Father Brun has written 3 books about the electronic voice phenomena, declaring it to be one of the most significant religious events of the century.
Through these experiments, we have more and more the proof of the life after the death.
Father Brun's most remarkable claim is that the Catholic Church itself first discovered the voice phenomena. Father Brun learnt this from another priest.
I know very well the Father Ernetti, and he told me a story, a very fantastic story.
In 1952, the Vatican's University in Milan had acquired a new electronic recorder. Father Ernetti was helping the Pope's chief scientist, Father Gemelli, to record chanted prayers.
They were trying in this laboratory to record voices of monks who were singing in Gregorian. There were only a wire recorders, and very often the wire broke. And one time, that was the 17th of November, 1952, the wire broke again. And since his childhood, Father Gemelli, when he had some difficulty in the life, said, "Oh, Father, help me," without thinking very strongly to his father each time. And this time he did again his small knot, and instead of hearing the voices singing in Gregorian, it was the voice of his father from the beyond, who said, "Of course I'm helping you. I am always with you." And Father Gemelli was afraid and stopped the record immediately. Of course, for Father Gemelli, at the beginning it was dreadful to hear the voice of his father, because in the Old Testament we have many passages saying all communication with the dead are forbidden.
Fire the room! Quick! March!
Thank you.
Well, the minister, Dr. Ferguson, is coming this afternoon, and he's going to look at the EVP equipment. I don't know how that will come out. I mean, there are things in the Bible which are probably not too favourable for that type of research, so we shall see what happens. The equipment over here.
Yes.
So if you would like to have a seat.
Thank you.
Here. Oops. Okay then. So
will you explain to me what's happening?
Well, I will explain what can be explained. And what cannot be explained, I leave to you. It does seem to be the voices from an origin which is not of this physical universe, you know, which is where I think the religious aspect comes
yes.
in.
So you're quite convinced that it's not from other stations?
I am quite convinced, yes.
It was obvious through the whole of the Old Testament that there was a prohibition against communicating with the dead. Saul himself advised that they should be cut out from among the people. Regard not them that have familiar spirits, neither seek after wizards to be defiled by them. But if one went to them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded though one rose from the dead.
In 1952, the two Catholic priests were so shaken by their discovery, they sought the highest religious advice.
After this experiment in Milan, they went to the Pope. It was Pius XII. They went to the Pope because they thought it was something fantastic, probably something which could help the faith to the eternal life.
As the Pope listened to the electronic voice, his priests asked if they had sinned by summoning the dead.
Pius XII had a very positive position, saying that a recorder is objective and cannot transform what he receives. He receives waves from another dimension and give again these waves without any influence from a medium. That is not the same thing as in Spiritism. And this could be the beginning of a scientific discovery who could help to the faith in the eternal life. This experiment, however, was not published, not yet.
Today, the Pope's pragmatic view of the Old Testament prohibitions is echoed by other churchmen.
I don't think so. Anything that can strengthen the faith is very welcome, whatever it is.
But if the proof is there, and it does seem to be there more and more...
It'll give respectability to faith.
Oh, that's a very good way of putting it.
The experimenter tells how difficult it is to convince people of the reality of the voice phenomenon.
While keeping its support for EVP a guarded secret, the Vatican publicly embraced the Swedish prophet of the voices and honoured Friedrich Jürgensen with a papal medal. With the Pope's covert backing, the phenomena spread around the world.
Now a voice says, mark you, make believe, my dear, yes.
Today, more than 30,000 believers in 87 countries belong to EVP societies and regularly use the phenomena to contact the dead.
Let's go now!
Demand to make leave my dear here. Demand to make leave my dear here.
Right, Denise, Helen and Irene, the recording that I took for the EVP session, let's see if there's anything there specially for you tonight, okay?
This girl.
Somebody's saying, this girl is taping. Can anybody recognise this?
Linda, that's Fiona. I know my daughter's voice. I've never forgotten my daughter's voice. It's not a thing you would ever forget. I've had a fantastic void in my life for years, and the void has closed. It's gone. I know she's with me. I know she's here. I mean, it's just... oh, wow.
It's, I swear, that he's saying Henry.
It's Henry.
Yeah, it's Henry. Listen.
It's Henry. Why is he whispering?
Well, when my dad died, he died with COAD, chronic obstructive airways disease.
He should be well now.
Where's your mama gone?
What Linda has is a gift.
Little baby gone.
A power to be able to reach beyond the grave. I do believe what we've heard tonight is a miracle.
I hope that everyone will be able to communicate with the dead and find that they're not dead after all. I just hope that's my aim. I want at least the knowledge that it is possible to do it, to be made available to everybody.
This one here, which I'm just going to play, seems to say it's Simon. I love you.
Simon, I love you. Simon, I love you.
Simon is sending a message wishing to convey to somebody that he loves them. And presumably somewhere, someone will recognize this voice and be reassured by this message.
Simon, I love you.
Where's your papa gone? Where's your papa gone?
Tomorrow at 9, Secrets of the Dead pieces together the mystery of who burnt Rome. Next tonight, the Sunday movie on 4. Freddie Prinze Jr. and Jennifer Love Hewitt star as teens with a terrible secret. I Know What You Did Last Summer. Next.